Welcome back. We are going to start this week looking at the interpretation. So far, we took about 5 weeks to understand how important it is for us to have this mindset, have an approach of looking at the scriptures in order to study, in order to observe, in order to go to the text with a heart and full of questions and curiosity. Now, after all that you do to your text, after all that your passage that you're studying, this is the second most important step. The first step, as I said, is key. It is the foundational aspect of our Bible study. Once you have gathered all the questions, once you have loaded yourself with the questions, what you do then? You must get your heart pounding to know what are the answers to the questions that I have on my notebook. As you sit with the Word of God, then this should be your next step. What is the meaning? What does the author intend to communicate to me through the words that are given here? What does he mean by these grammatical sentences that he meant or that appear here? What does he mean by the narration that is there? What does he mean by the logic that he's trying to use? What does he mean by the parable that he's trying to use? These are the questions we will be answering in the coming weeks. So we will begin with our second step, which is interpretation. Before we go further, let me just give you a quick word about observation and interpretation. This is by Howard Hendricks, and I took it from the Austin website. See what he said. He said, in observation, we excavate, which means we dig out. In interpretation, we... Then he said, and buildings are always determined by their foundations. The more substantial the foundation, the more substantial the superstructure, right? In the same way, the quality of your interpretation will always depend on the quality of your observation. It is impossible to understand what a writer means and to notice what the writer says. Therefore, to observe well is to interpret well. You always need to observe with a view to interpreting and eventually to applying the scripture. Observation is never an end in itself, but always a means to an end. And we saw last 5 weeks, how we need to excavate the scripture, how we need to ask those questions of when, where, why, what, who, and also how, and how we need to discover the structure, discover the way a particular passage is composed and all of that. But then the second part, as you say here, is observation is about excavating, interpretation is about basically building or seeing what the answers are. These are the two sides of the same coin. You cannot interpret without observation. You cannot observe properly without willing to find answers. So that's the quick word about interpretation and observation. Before we go any further, we are going to also look at what interpretation is not and what interpretation is. So as you see the colors put down there on the left side, particularly firstly, we will look at what is not interpretation, right? And some of the ideas that we have incorporated, some of the patterns that we follow, you might want to unlearn. Then you might incorporate the ideas that we will learn today about what is interpretation. So here on the left side, you will see what it is not. On the right side, you will see what it is. So let's begin with what it is not. It is not assuming. So when you read "For God so loved the world," you do not assume what "for" means. You do not assume what the word "world" means. Does it mean everybody? Does it mean the physical world? Does it mean every single person? Or does it mean only few people? What does God mean when he says the word "world"? And if he says God loves the world, why does he in 1 John chapter 2 verse 15 to 17 says don't love the world? And how come he loves the world? So number one, you don't assume what the meaning is by saying world means maybe everybody. And then you will contradict when you come to 1 John 2:15 when you look at those words, do not love the world. So don't assume the meaning. But what do? Then you discover. You go to the scripture to discover what the meaning is. What's the difference between assuming and discovering? Assuming, you already thought of an answer. Discovering, you don't know what the answer is. You're going to the text with a fresh mind to say, I want to know. Can you teach me what the meaning of the world is or righteousness is? So these are the primary two differences. The next one, not enforcing. You don't push a particular idea that you have on the meaning of the text. Then what is it? It is deriving. You wait long enough at the text and you have asked all the questions that you need to ask. And then you say, what do I deduct? What do I derive from the entire equation, from the entire logic, from all the flow of thought that has been, you know, put before me so far, from all the movements of the characters and all the conversations that have happened, all the logic that is presented, what do I deduct? You never force your own idea. because you have some meaning about a particular word. Because with being, you know, as humanity progresses with changing times, language changes, meanings change. So therefore, you wait and derive what the answer is. What else is interpretation? What else it is not ignoring? Sometimes when we come to particular texts, we carefully, faithfully ignore. We don't care to know what the meaning is, because either you are in a hurry, you have to quickly finish your quiet time so that you're feeling so that you don't feel guilty, and many reasons. And therefore, you ignore nothing to do, because the scripture is given for our study. What interpretation is not and what interpretation is, we said it's not assuming, it is discovering what the text says. I don't go to the scripture and enforce my own ideas, but I wait at the text and look at all the logical arguments that are presented, and I derive the meaning, and I don't ignore because I don't understand something, but I wait and carefully use all my abilities to determine and say, okay, this only should be the meaning. It can't be anything else. Okay. Don't worry about keeping the whole thing in mind. You'll anyways be given the PPT, but more so we will be doing a few exercises that will help you get a bit sharper with what I'm teaching today. Right. Secondly, and then after that, it's not reading into. I don't look at a passage and say, okay, this person is after this person, which means this person. This is a very important word in our entire study. The meaning of the word is not determined by you, or the meaning of the word is not at your mercy. You cannot subjective, you know, resources to somehow come up with a meaning. It is objective. What is objective? Objective means God has already decided a meaning for the text. Your job is, as a faithful student, is to pray and use all our abilities, looking at the text, understand this should be the meaning. It can't be anything else. This only should be the meaning. This is why in observation we learn the first thing is we must depend on the Holy Spirit. We cannot take a chance. We cannot do it by our strength. With all the study that we do, it's not by our understanding. Unless God gives a man, John the Baptist said, he cannot receive anything from unless God gives him, right? So it's not subjective, it is objective. In short, the interpretation is not my invention. It is understanding God's intention, right? Look at those two things. It is not reader's invention. I don't invent the meaning, but I am waiting and I'm willing to know God's intention. That is the simple thing. If I have to put it in one word, interpretation is not about my invention of a meaning, but my study to know the intention behind a particular text. Right? Now let's look at the two words that are used. This side, the wrong side, the side we are not supposed to fall into, is called eisegesis. Is a fancy word which simply means you are putting your own meanings to the text. The right side, the right way of studying or interpreting the scripture is called exegesis. The word exegesis is literally means to lead out or to draw out. So what do you do when you come to the scripture? You say interpretation, it's there on the screen, is the process of applying rules by which the meaning and the message of the biblical text is determined and understood. Our goal is deciding on the single meaning of the passage when it was originally written to the original audience. In short, go to the text, study long enough, and say, Lord, what did you mean when you said this particular word, or when you gave this particular thought, or when you wrote down this particular word to the primary audience? Whatever it meant to them, it means to us. So what is interpretation? Interpretation is simply learning or understanding God's intention when he first wrote it to the primary audience. Many modern readers, I did it. I try to sometimes now do it. Probably most of you are doing. You read the scripture and directly jump to how does it apply to me? That's a dangerous step. That You're assuming that God is directly speaking to you. Yes, but God first spoke to a particular audience, a local audience, whether it was in Israel or in Corinth or in Rome. God primarily spoke to them. You need to know what God meant to them. The meaning never changes. When you know the meaning of what God said to them, that is when you know of what God is saying to you and me right now. So we looked at what interpretation is. Now we are going to look at why interpretation is important. Is it important? Did God leave it to the hands of only Bible teachers, great theologians, and great pastors? Or does God want every one of us to interpret? And if so, what is the importance behind interpretation? Let me give you a few truths. First, there's a scripture portion here. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 19 and 20. Peter is writing to the church that is suffering, and then he says, knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. I want to give you a few principles from this passage as to why it is important for 19 or 20 or whatever number we have here. Every one of you who is attending, why is it important for you to know and interpret the scripture, right? Look at the first principle. You need to interpret because you need to know God's meaning. Otherwise, you will make your own meaning, or you will receive a meaning that has been attached to that word by some popular preachers without examining the text, or you will ignore it. Three possibilities. You will make your own meaning, or you will attach some meaning that you heard a popular preacher or teacher give without examining the scripture properly, or you will ignore it. And all three are dangerous. God has an interpretation. That's why it says no prophecy of scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. Nothing. Every single word in the Bible has nobody has given it its own interpretation. Whether Paul wrote it, Moses wrote it, David wrote it, whoever wrote it. Then how did it come? See, it says it was produced by, not by the will of man, but men spoke from God. So the second principle is this. The meaning of God's word is decided by God and not man. So therefore, we cannot have multiple interpretations for any given text. One church can't have one interpretation. Another church can't have another interpretation. No, there can't be. There may be a few areas where we may debate about what could be the meaning. But we cannot basically have divisions about cardinal or fundamental or the most foundational aspects of Christian life. God decided the meaning. God won't change the meaning from generation to generation and from church to church. That is why you can read the scripture with confidence and know there's one meaning. I want to know the meaning. Applications can be many, but meaning can be only one. And then the third thing is, it says God the Holy Spirit carried people. You know, men were carried by him, their emotions, their ideas, their background was used to write. Therefore, you need to depend on the Spirit of God, while you also need to look at the human author and the human recipients and their existing circumstances to understand it. So why is it important? So that you know God's interpretation, so that you also know God himself has decided the meaning, and by depending on the Spirit, you begin to study human authors and their recipients, and then you understand. Another principle is there in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. This is what is written to a young pastor by the name of Timothy at the church of Ephesus. What did Paul write? Paul is saying, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. Paul is writing to a pastor. Now you can say, this is only for pastor. No, it begins with the pastor. That's the rule for everybody. Everybody. What should we do? Rightly handle the word of truth. In Greek, the meaning, literal meaning is to cut the word appropriately. To cut it appropriately, which means nobody can do whatever they want with the Holy Bible. No. You must learn to chisel out. You must learn to understand what did the author mean when he said these particular words. And I am excited today as we are going to do a few exercises. I believe we will have some brainstorming. We will have to put our minds together and shape our thinking, unlearn a few things, learn a few things based on what is being taught. So the principle here is fourth principle. Why should I interpret? Because we are commanded. You must interpret. That's what it says. to Timothy and to all the believers, to rightly cut the word, to rightly divide the word, to rightly interpret the word. So there you go, four principles. And the fifth one, Acts 17, when Paul goes to a place called Berea, after ministering at Thessalonica, Bereans were called more noble than the believers at Thessalonica. Why? The answer is given there. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. Once a brother was preaching from this text in a place, and he said, if Paul and Silas were scrutinized, if what they taught was right or wrong compared to the word of God, who else is exempt? You can't just take what I am teaching and say this is the truth. You can't just take one great preacher or teacher. No, go and examine the text and see, like the Bereans, if what they are saying is right or wrong. Now, in order for you to do that, you must be equipped enough, right? That's why they were called more noble people. And somebody said, I think it's my father-in-law who said, that is why probably Paul never had to write a letter to the believers at Berea. Right? There's no letter called Epistle to Bereans, right? Why? Because they were more noble, maybe, and they were studying the scripture even to scrutinize Paul and Silas. So last principle, it is both your responsibility and your duty to interpret the scriptures. You may want to go through them again if you listen to the recording, but at least keep these things in mind. It's a command from God. You will know the God's meaning when he wrote the scripture, and it is your duty, and therefore you must take this seriously. So we looked at two things: what it is not, interpretation, why is it important. Now let's go to the next one. We will now begin, and probably with the given time that we have, we will try and aim at learning two principles of interpretation, right? So here you are. If you have come so far, congratulations. I want to encourage you to keep the pace going, to keep up your excitement. I want you to read, study, devote your time. Don't say you are busy, because that what you're doing may not matter when you stand before the Lord if you're not giving enough time to the study of the scriptures, right? So if you learned observation, interpretation, first principle. What is the first principle? It is called interpreting the scripture literally. You would have heard the word literal. Many times we use the word literal, right? When you want to say somebody, you know, did something and you want to emphasize it, you would say, he literally did that. What you mean is, he did it. There's no exaggeration. There's no, I'm not trying to diminish any value of saying he literally did it. So when you read the scriptures, the first principle you must remember is, go to the Holy Bible, read any text, and take it literally. Let me give you a few, let me expound a little on this. Number one, literal means literal. It's plain, ordinary, simple meaning that we have in our day-to-day conversations. When somebody tells you, I feel sad today, you don't attach any spiritual meanings to it. You mean, you understand it as, probably this person is really feeling sad. You won't say, maybe there is a spiritual component behind it. You don't try to read into it. You don't try to, you know, think there is a hidden meaning. This brother is not able to express is not what you would say. You just take it at its face value, because it is a daily, it is a common conversation. So also when you come to the Holy Bible, it is a literal meaning. When God says something, take it. There's no hidden meaning to it. That's the first thing. Now, While having said that, I will come back to aspects of what is hidden to us when we come to understanding the meaning of the word. But for now, it is plain, ordinary, simple meaning. The meaning that we have in our daily conversations, right? Second thing, God spoke to us in human language, using human authors, with human terms to convey the divine message. So don't ever overthink. Right? When you look at any passage, know that God, you know, basically is using human beings and their stories to give us basic, simple human meanings. Because human authors were used, human words were used, and God is trying to convey a divine message through these things. The third thing. Why is this principle important? Dr. Chuck Missler, a teacher, said, God means what he says, and he says what he means. If God is the author of language and he has given us language to communicate and primarily for us to hear what he says, then he is not trying to play hide and seek with you. He means what he's saying. Albeit you and I need to break our heads about what is the real meaning. But you don't have to break your heads about what does he mean? I don't understand. And I read the scriptures. Many people complain saying, I don't understand the scriptures. Either we don't understand language properly or we are basically entertainment zombies whose minds are not working well, functioning well at their, with their best capacity because we have lost our aptitude to understand conversations. Right? So what is the first principle when you go to the Holy Bible? Literal, simple, plain, ordinary. Whatever God is speaking there, he means it. Let's do our first exercise, right? You're ready. So I want anybody to unmute themselves and speak. I have placed a verse there, Genesis 2:7. I'll read it for you. This is the assignment. I want you to tell me whatever the underlying statements there. You see that in yellow color in the screen, on the screen there. Tell me what God meant when he wrote those words. Then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living creature. Simple, please explain it to me. The admin will unmute you. Please feel free to talk or at least send me a chat. What does God mean when he wrote the account of Genesis through Moses that God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils and man became a living creature? Anybody?
It means that God took mud like dust and made a man in the image, like, and then he put air into his nostrils and thereby the man became a living creature.
Exactly. I hope it is Pallavi. Pallavi, you nailed it. It's as simple as it is. And Prashant said, God found man with his own hands. Absolutely. For the first time, God, the creator, touched something. So far, it's just been verbal. He scooped, you know, some dust. And then he found man and he breathed into his nostrils. And then the man became a living soul. And yeah, we can always find meanings like, we are, like Rohila said, we are more valuable than any other creatures and all those things. Perfect. But the simple, plain, ordinary, straightforward meaning is that God created man with his hands and by dust, by taking the dust, and then he breathed into his nostrils. That's all. Let's do one more thing. Okay, Deepika said God made man from the dust and when he put air into his nostrils, man came into life. As simple as that. As simple as that, right? Let's just look at one more assignment. Okay, keep yourselves unmuted and then tell me what it means in John 8:28 when God said, I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. What is Jesus trying to say? Anybody? What does Jesus mean when he said, I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. I am he basically means that I am the Son of God, the Messiah, who alone can save you from your sins. That's the meaning, if you look at the context, if I'm not wrong. So what do you understand from it? You see, we're finding it even difficult to answer because it is so simple. It is so literal. It is as plain as that. And most of the times we come to the scripture with to find, I'll show you what all we want to find later. Emiaka said, you will die a sinner if you don't believe. Just simple as that. She named it. You will die as a sinner if you don't believe that I am your savior, that Jesus is the savior. That's what he's trying to say. You see, many times we come to the scriptures to find some mystical meanings. And therefore, we miss the obvious. We will look at one more passage. But I'm going to trick you here, right? Luke 13:31-32. At that very hour, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you. And he said to them, Jesus said to them, to the Pharisees, go and tell that fox, behold, I cast out demons and perform cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I finished my course. This is the question. What did the Pharisees mean when he said Herod wants to kill you? And what does Jesus mean when he said, tell that fox? What did Jesus mean when he said, I am going to cast out demons and perform cures? Please answer now. If it is possible, if you can, don't chat. If you're in a position, otherwise it's okay. You can go ahead and chat because this will take some explanation. What did Pharisees mean when they told Jesus, Herod wants to kill you? And Jesus said, go tell that fox, I cast out demons and perform cures. What did he mean? Yeah, if you want to chat.
I have some unfinished work to do.
Okay, I didn't understand. Come again.
Probably Jesus is saying, I have still unfinished work to do here.
I want you to answer me as to what Pharisees meant and Jesus meant in terms of what is underlined there in the yellow text. Herod wants to kill you. What are the Pharisees saying?
Go save yourself.
Yeah, so is Herod really going to kill Jesus?
No, no. Actually, Herod really wants to see him.
Okay. You see? So what did he mean when he said Herod wants to kill you? What did they mean?
That is their intention, and actually.
How do you know that is their intention and not Herod's intention?
Herod is not pleased with what you're doing properly.
Exactly, but I want to say this is as simple as that Herod really wanted to kill Jesus. I mean, Herod's father or grandfather wanted to kill Jesus when Jesus was a baby. What would stop this Herod from killing Jesus, especially when he's going around, at least the talk of the town is that this man is the new king, the new Caesar. Now, if you didn't get that, that's okay. Tell me what Jesus meant when he said, go tell that fox. Think and answer. What did Jesus mean when he said, go tell that fox?
It is not literally the fox, but here it's like the attitude of the fox he was mentioning. Regarding the Herod. Perfect.
See, what Jesus was trying to say. Yeah, somebody else also messaged me. Pallavi, you said it so well. Yes, Joy Adler said, nature of fox and Herod. Attitude of fox, Rohila. Very good. Very good, right? That's exactly what Jesus meant. See, when Pharisees said Herod wants to kill you, they meant it. But when Jesus said, go tell that fox, he did not mean that Herod was a fox. But the attitude of a fox that Herod had, right? And then when he moved on to say, I cast out demons and perform cures, he's not speaking figuratively, but he's really saying, I'm really going to cast out demons and also perform cures, right? You remember one of the principles we learned last week about how to identify a figurative speech or a word that is used figuratively? We said, if a word in the sentence doesn't make sense in its natural way, then it must be a figure of speech. Last week I mentioned that. I'm just reiterating what I said. If a word in a sentence doesn't make sense when it is read in a natural or doesn't make natural sense, common sense, it must be a figure of speech. So Jesus is definitely not saying Herod is a fox. But Jesus is saying a person who is very cunning, looks like he's a good person in outwardly, but inwardly filled with basically bitterness, greed, envy, and murderous thoughts and all those things. But when he said, I cast out demons, he's not using the figurative language. How do we know? Because Jesus really cast out demons. Jesus really performed cures. So this is what I want to say now. Left side, Genesis 2:7 and John 8:28 basically are plain literal meanings. There is no hidden messages there. However, listen to this carefully. However, understanding of Genesis 2:7 gets enriched and falls and enlightened when we study the scripture in depth, and also when we get the vastness of the scripture. However, the basic meaning doesn't change. God still made man from the earth with dust and breathed into his nostrils, and does not change. But our understanding of that meaning, our understanding of the text, can be enlarged as we study more scripture and as we get into the depth of the scripture more and more. But the basic meaning doesn't change because it is plain and it is literal. But on the right side, it is figurative literal. It is still literal, but it is using some figures of speech. Why is it important? When we don't know the difference, there's a famous preacher in Hyderabad. I shall leave the name, we shall not talk about his name. But a famous preacher in Hyderabad who draws scores of people to his meetings on Saturdays or Sundays, who's a Telugu preacher, stood on the stage and made a blunder, and nobody could tell him back. And the blunder was, he said from the stage that the point that he was trying to make was anointing. And then he said, when anointing steps into your life, enemies will become friends. And you know what text he chose? He chose the text in Luke where Jesus, while just before he was being crucified, he's under trial. So first he goes to Annas and Caiaphas, and then they send him to Pilate, and Pilate says, no, he's under the jurisdiction of Galilee, so he must go to Herod. You know what happens when he's sent to Herod? There's a scripture verse that says, when this incident happened, Herod and Pilate became friends. You know what interpretation he gave? He said, when anointing steps into your life, enemies will become friends. That is not the meaning of the text. That is plain literal. That means to say those people became friends because of that incident that took place. That has nothing to do with anointing. That has nothing to do with God's anointing. When God's anointing is upon your life, even enemies will become your friends. No, there are two wicked people. Now, people who willingly, knowingly rejected to give a fair trial to the Lord Jesus Christ. But that's the interpretation he gave. Very plain, very literal. You see what blunders can be made? And if you are part of the listening audience, you would say, wow, what a brilliant truth, man. I never saw something like this. I must follow this preacher. And on the way, you will be off track, and you never know where you wonder if you're even a believer after a while. So my friends, number one principle, when you read the scriptures, we'll do a few more exercises. It is plain, it is literal, except when figurative words are used, right? Look at this. In the Holy Bible, according to this man, William Bullinger, who lived between that time, there are 200 figures of speech used in the Holy Bible. Sarcasm was used, metaphors were used, similes were used, idioms were used, phrases were used, and so many other things were used, right? You don't have to know everything. All you need to know is read a plain sentence. Wherever it is plain, ordinary, simple meaning, take it. When you see a figure of speech, pause and ask. If you can't, we will learn other principles as we move forward. But please do yourself this favor by taking the scripture at its face value. Let me take you to the next slide. Literal interpretation means taking the word of God at its face value and giving it the due credit we give any sensible conversation we hold with another person, while being mindful of all the literary techniques used to convey God's word to us. I want you to keep two things in mind. Literal interpretation means whatever God says, he means. Take it. Just like you take it when you talk to two people, right? Our intimacy, our depth of our conversation depends on our intimacy. So also when you get closer to the Lord, you will understand the word in a deeper way. But that doesn't mean there are hidden meanings. The word of God, take it at its face value. However, be mindful of all the literary techniques that are used, like figures of speech, like grammar, like the historical context. You need to be mindful of all those things. Now, who doesn't understand that? Okay, let me give you a few let's just take one example. You can unmute yourself and talk. How many of you used knife in your life? Knife. Just say yes or no, or send me a quick thumbs up or yes or no or something like that. Knife, you saw a knife, you heard about a knife, you used it. Yeah, thanks. Deepika raised the hand. I'm assuming all of you do, right? Now listen, if I say, let's say Ravikant, I know Ravikant here. So I say, I'm introducing Ravikant. And to somebody, a friend of mine, I say, Ravikant, kattila untadu. Now, what am I trying to say? You know what I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say this guy is smart. This guy is handsome. This guy is brilliant. I am in no way giving an indication that Ravikant can be used to cut vegetables. That's not what I'm saying. Now, who doesn't understand that figure of speech? But you see, in order to understand that figure of speech, you need to live in this time, understand this language, and come from this part of the country. If you're living in the north, you won't understand why. Language is a barrier. The cultural concept that I created in your mind is a barrier. Again, if you are from South India and you're living in the Telugu states and you are part not of this generation, but you were born, let's say, in the 1950s or 1940s, the word kattila untadu will not make sense. Why? Because that probably that kind of a phrase or idiom was not invented back then. You see, even in our own times, even in our own language, if you move from one generation to another generation, the meaning of the word has changed, or probably that meaning that didn't exist. So also, when you read the Holy Bible, a lot of it is plain, literal, simple, ordinary meaning, except when there are figurative languages, figurative words that are used, or other literary techniques that are used. So want to drill this into your mind? Remember, literal, literal, literal. Now, please get this. I think we'll only be able to do one today. See this. When you look at literal meaning, it doesn't mean everything is at its face value. Why? Because literal basically means you want to know, when you are using the word literal interpretation, you want to know this. What did the author intend to communicate through his words? That's what you want to know, right? Now, let me just put one example before you here. This is the example, right? Romans 3:21 to 26. Just give it a brief reading. And look at all the yellow words that I mentioned there. And then my question to you is, after you read, do you know the meaning of those words? Okay. So take a good look at this. I'll give you about less than a minute. And then answer how many meanings of those words do you know? If you at least gave it one read, these are the words. Do you know the meaning of righteousness of God? Do you know the meaning of manifested? Do you know the meaning of the word the law? And what does it mean by the law and the prophets bear witness to it? What's the meaning of the word faith, by the way? What's the meaning of the word believe? What's the meaning of the word sinned? Is it smoking, drinking, adultery, pornography? What does he mean by sinned? And all have sinned. When did all sin, and what is that common sin? And then he's speaking about falling short. Generally, when you think of fall short, you're thinking of, what did I fall short of? Right? What does he mean by the glory of God? What does he mean by grace, redemption, justified? We only use that word when we are using a word, right? When we are writing something on Word and you control all and you want to justify it, you want to put it in order, you use, you know, control J. What does he mean by justified? What does he mean by the word propitiation? When did you use that word in your normal conversation at all? When did we use the word redemption? Like, what does he mean? So Rohila got an answer. She said, sin means going against the law. Wonderful. Any other answers? Anybody else? What does he mean by God is just and justifier? What does he mean by forbearance? Now, to keep it short, if you already read it, if you carefully observe, general answers that come up in your mind usually fall into the what is not interpretation category. Remember, we assume, we enforce, or we try to invent. More often than not, our answers may not exactly match the actual meaning of the original word. So we think, when we think of righteousness, That's a word that we don't use. It's a legal term, right? Justified, a legal time, propitiation, a word that is used in sacrifices or atonement or things like that. These are not regular words, manifested. I mean, who will say, let's say, today Nehemiah Anna manifested himself before a Zoom meeting? We don't speak like that, right? So what do you do? You generally, when you read a text like this, you quickly want to get something out of it. So you fall into what is not interpretation category. You take one of those approaches, you assume something, you enforce something, you give it something, you invent a meaning, and you try to add to it. And that is when you will miss knowing God's actual intention. So what should you do then? I'll tell you just in a while. But see, all these words, when you know the meaning of all these words, even if you studied just this passage for, let's say, 1 week, but you waited and asked the Lord and you did some exercises, you will come out of your Bible study richly benefited. But if you don't, you are like that, you know, 2 minute Maggie kind of person, you want just quick answers, then you will say, God is not speaking to me. Another thing, John 3:19 to 21. What does Jesus mean when he said, this is the judgment? The light has come into the world. Is he talking about the sunlight? World. What does he talk when he said, what does he mean when he means the world? If the light doesn't mean sunlight, what world is he talking about? This is the world we live in. Is he talking about people? And then what does he mean that people love the darkness? How can you love darkness? Darkness is not a person. It doesn't have a will. So what does he mean? Does he mean, is there another meaning for the word darkness? Or is he using it in a figurative way to help me understand a particular meaning? What does he mean by their works are evil? People can be evil. How can people's works be evil? What does he mean by wicked things? What does he mean by exposed? What does he mean by carried out in God? Now, I just highlighted words that I felt, you know, are important and key in these passages. You can do it with every word. So, my point is this. When you go to the scripture, the meaning is literal. That doesn't mean every word, the meaning of every word is very clear there. We have to struggle and grapple and wrestle with the original language, which is this. You wrestle and you say, Lord, what do you want me to know? Now tell me, with who of us have not gone to colleges or schools and did not learn terminologies, words, right? Some of the words are alien to us, but we still learn them because they express a particular idea. Let's say you're in accounting department or you're in science department. There are so many words, engineering department, or you're training to be a lawyer. There are so many words and ideas you learn. You will never sit there and question, I don't like the word, therefore I will not learn. What happens? You will be the loser. So also with the word of God, you need to go and ask. And you will only learn once, because once you learn, you only get enhanced, enriched, the more you begin to study. So I still haven't gotten to how to find the meaning for these words. I'm only telling you so far. Number one principle, literal. Take it at its face value. Number two, there are figures of speech. Ask what it means in the context. We will go there. Number three, please pay attention. Just because it is literal, it doesn't mean every word's meaning is easily understood. There are gaps between the original text and the audience. Why? There are historical gaps. There are linguistic gaps. There are so many gaps. Therefore, you must invest your time in understanding this. And it becomes a mindset and you will know the meaning. So what is the meaning for these words? Righteousness of God, manifested, law, prophets, justified. What is the meaning? How do I find? That's the real thing, right? That's the real thing. Okay, and I understood literal. I will not, you know, try to conk up this thing. But how do I find the meaning? How do we know the definition of meaning? I'll come back to that slide. How do we know the definition of words and meanings? Number one, there are some do. You must do these things. And there are some don'ts also. Okay, number one, let's go with the do's. First thing, this is what you do. Please have a good study Bible. As simple as that. Because study Bibles will generally give you the meanings. When you don't have the time, this is what I mean to say. When you don't have the time to sit and know the meaning of every word, go to a study Bible. Use a study Bible. Difficult words, meanings are generally given. Otherwise, use a good Bible dictionary. I'm not joking. good preachers, good teachers use a good Bible dictionary. Right? Third thing, use a good Bible concordance. What is a concordance? A concordance is a book where you will have a related meaning of a word from the entire Holy Bible. Now, there are many things that are available for free online. Please own them, or else invest and buy a copy of a good Bible concordance. We invest in so many things that wear out and that don't give any, that don't add any value to our life. So please invest in a good study Bible, a good Bible dictionary, a good Bible concordance. The next thing is use a good Bible that has cross references. Most Bibles have cross references. Like you're reading a verse. Otherwise, if you're an online reader like me, you read it on iPad or phone, what you can do, there are cross references. Please, when you find the time, go through all the cross references. I do go through all the cross references. What cross references do is enhance and enlighten the meaning of a word that is not understood to you at that particular time. Study Bible, dictionary, concordance, cross references that are there. Follow the footnotes if there are any footnotes there. At the end, you have free, simple Greek and Hebrew Bibles available online, okay? With transliteration, which means you know the how the word is pronounced and you know the exact original meaning also given there. It's very simple. I follow it. You can also do it. Once you have finished reading, go and read it. My friends, I want to encourage you. Reading the Bible, studying doesn't take much time if you are willing and you are passionate about it. So you want to know the meaning of what is the righteousness of God? You will go to a study Bible. If you don't find it there, go to a Bible dictionary and say, what does it mean? And probably they'll give a Greek word and a meaning. You don't have to break your heads. People have already spent years to study, learn, and put it before you in a simple format. You at least do this basic thing of going to these books and finding the answers. Go through all the cross references. And the best thing you can do is go to the original manuscript, which is Greek, right? And Hebrew. And transliterations are available. Online Scripture for All is a good site. Bible Hub is a good site. Just say Hebrew, English, interlinear Bible. Greek, English, interlinear Bible, right? And then you will find it. You will be amazed to see what the actual meaning is and not how it is translated. You'll be amazed. What should you not do to find a meaning? Don't spiritualize. Okay? Don't give it some kind of spiritual meaning. Number two, don't mysticize. Don't think this has some kind of a very deep hidden meaning and then try to attach all sorts of meanings to it, right? Some people come back from Bible study and you ask them, how was the Bible study? Deep. Brother, deep means what do you mean? What do you mean? Even a ditch is deep. What do you mean? You need to know the plain meaning. If the plain meaning is not given and you're not able to tell back what the meaning is, you haven't understood much. Third thing is, don't allegorize. What is allegorize? Allegorize is basically taking any passage and trying to kind of think of another story as if it is there behind that story and try to say, this is the hidden meaning. It is not known to many people, but I now understood the meaning. For example, a lot of people, parables are allegorized, right? For example, somebody said, I heard this preach by somebody in when I was young. One man said, basically, Jesus... David, when he wanted to kill Goliath, he took 5 stones. J-E-S-U-S, Jesus. And somebody said, when David wanted to kill Goliath, he took 5 things. Basically, what are the 5 things that will help you, kill Goliath in your life? Faith, patience, love, prayer, word of God. But they never tell you why only 1 thing worked. What about the rest of the 4? This is allegorizing. This is trying to see something that is not there. So don't allegorize. And then when you don't know the meaning, don't contemporarize. What is contemporarize? Don't add an existing meaning that we have in our time to the meaning of the word that is there. For example, the word slavery in the 17th, 15th centuries in America is entirely different from the word slavery in the Bible times. Slaves those times were highly educated professionals also. That's not the meaning in the 17th century of America or probably even in India. So don't add a meaning that you know of something now and add it to the meaning there. That is why you need to take time to study the Bible. You need to wait and say, what is the righteousness of God? I don't understand. So let me open a good study Bible. Let me go to a good Bible dictionary. Let me look at what the Greek word is. Next one, don't moralize. You understand that, right? Find some moral out of everything and somehow follow. And don't legalize. It is there. I must follow. I don't care what the meaning is. Let me follow. I will tell you of one person from a place that I know, I shall leave it unnamed, in Hyderabad, who told me that he doesn't want to cut the sides of the beard because it says so in the book of Leviticus. I was shocked to hear that from another person. Now, there are so many laws. Why only that law? So many laws. Circumcision is there and so many hundreds of things are there. If there is a patch in your house, if there is a fungi in your house, what you need to do is also there. Why don't we follow everything? So don't legalize. So basically, friends, when you go to a particular text, don't forget one thing. You are there to know the author's intention communicated through his words. Nothing more, nothing less. Okay. Now, quickly, I want to take you back to one another thing. And I want to show you this. Yeah. See this. Can the author's intentions be misunderstood and misinterpreted by our own thoughts, feelings, presumptions, and preconceptions? Can this happen? Can God say something? And because we are feeling, thinking, and we have our own thoughts and preconceptions, can we misinterpret? Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm going to place two examples before you. The first example is taken from John Piper's Look at the Book series. You know, that's the thing there. If you want, you can copy and just go ahead and see. The second example is in my own, and I took it from the scripture. Look at this. What I want you to do is, can somebody volunteer? Jesse, can you volunteer and please read this passage? And then once Jesse reads, the question is this. Did the disciples understand or not? And the second question is, what did they not understand? What did Jesus help them understand? Jesse, can you read, please?
Yes, sir. After saying these things, he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will recover." Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought that he meant taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus has died."
Friends, please help me find the answer. Did Jesus communicate to them? Did they understand? What did they not understand? And what did they understand? And why did they come to that particular conclusion? Please quickly answer. Anybody?
Disciples thought when Jesus said that Lazarus has fallen into sleep, the disciples thought that Lazarus is into general sleep. He might be taking rest.
Yes. Yeah.
But Jesus meant that sleep in the sense he died.
Yeah.
So that is what. So
that's what they said. So my second question is, what was their response? What did they say?
Yeah, so when they said that if he's asleep, then he'll be taking rest, right? So he will recover.
Look at the humor there. They would have thought, and imagine Thomas was the one guy doing the talk. If I'm not wrong, he says, if he's sleeping, let him sleep. He'll wake up, right? Why do you want to travel from here all the way there to wake him up, right? But then, did Jesus explain the meaning of what he meant when he said fallen asleep? Yes. And what's the meaning? Can you tell me, please?
Yes, so he said very clearly and plainly that Lazarus has died.
Lazarus is dead.
Yes.
What was the problem with them? Please tell me, do you find any word there that will help us understand their problem? Anybody? Sister or anybody else?
They were taking the literal sense.
Exactly. You see, they thought that he meant. So what they are thinking that Jesus is literally saying he meant he's sleeping. But what did Jesus mean? He died. And look at the word. Jesus plainly told. Absolutely, in the scripture, there are words that are not plain. Unless Jesus, through his spirit, makes it plain. That doesn't mean you take figurative words as literal and literal words as figurative. Now see this, friends. Who was the audience? Disciples. Who was the speaker? Jesus. If Jesus spoke directly in their time to them, in their language, in words that they could understand and they still misunderstood. The gap is huge, right? Can we not misunderstand with our thoughts, preconceptions, feelings, ideas, and all the circumstances we are living in? Absolutely, we can. So this is a precaution. You need to not look at the things I told you. Don't moralize, spiritualize, mysticize. Don't just contemporize, right? Be careful. And what do you do? Ask Jesus. The best thing that you see here is they put out their thoughts. They didn't ignore. They didn't just go by what they felt. They had a thought. They misunderstood. They spoke to Jesus. You go to the scripture and say, Lord, does righteousness mean that you are right and you want me to be right? God will say, son, it is more than that. It's not just sleeping, he's dead. And God will make things very clear to you, friends. Very clear to you. Now, the second example is my own. Anybody can volunteer and read. Guys, don't waste time. We have a lot more to cover. One of you can volunteer and read and others can answer. Ravikant, can you volunteer for me, please? John 2, 18 to 22.
Sure. So the Jews said to him, what sign do you show for us doing these things? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken.
Simple. Can somebody wants to explain what the problem was, what Jesus said, what Jesus meant, who understood, who didn't understand, when they understood and all of that quickly? Anybody? What did they say? Show us a sign as to why you're doing whatever you're doing. And what did Jesus say? I'll show you the sign. The sign is destroy the temple. And he particularly said this temple. And then he said in 3 days I'll raise it up. Right? What did the Jews understand that temple to be?
They thought physical temple, Anna.
Physical temple, literal temple. And it took 46 years. And they say that by the time Jesus said that, even temple construction was still going on at some part, if I'm not wrong. But what was he talking about?
He was talking about his body.
The temple of his body. Now, did anybody understand that when he said it?
No.
No.
Nobody. Even the disciples only understood and believed the scripture when he rose. When he rose from the... Sorry. Oh, sorry, guys. When he rose from the dead. All I'm trying to convince you this evening is this. If they lived in that time, if Jesus literally spoke to them in plain human words with human meanings, they could not understand. How can we, living in our time, just take it for granted that we understand everything and just spend about 15, 20 minutes, half an hour and say, done? It's not possible. It's not possible at all. And you cannot stand before the Almighty on the day of judgment and say, you didn't give me enough time to study the word. John Piper, I think, said that Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and other social media platforms, probably on the day of judgment, will stand to witness before God that we had time. That we had time. So, first principle of interpretation, literal, plain, ordinary, simple, everyday, conversational words are used to convey meaning, divine meaning. Number two, that doesn't mean every word you can understand. There are gaps we need to cover. So what do? Study. Invest more time. Sleep less. Eat less. Wake up early. Sleep late. Whatever you want to do. Let the word of God be fed into your life, mind, and soul by giving it the utmost. Next, there are figurative words used. There are so many things that come into, in fact, just like in our conversations every day, just like, know what is being said. And if you don't, like the disciples, express your thoughts. And the Spirit of God, when you depend on Him in prayer, as you express, the Lord will lead you into more clarity. Unfortunately, today you are stuck with me. We don't have breakout room, so we will continue, right? This is my favorite part. We looked at plain, literal, and how to find the meaning. Next one, second principle. This is the most important principle. Context. Context. We have time till 7:30. I'll keep you till then and then I'll close. The second most and probably the most influential principle of all the principles that you will learn. I don't want to diminish the value of other things, but this is most important, which is interpret any passage in its context. Okay, let's start. Context is the single most important factor for correct interpretation. Great, great people. So many people, you know, get wrong here. Context is the single most important factor for correct interpretation. Let me ask you this question. What is context? I want you to please unmute yourselves and please talk. What do you understand by the word context? Anybody, please.
It is the content or the subject, the narrator, trying to explain.
Wow. Sister, you use three words. Content, subject, narrator is trying to use. Beautiful. So the idea here is the narrator, the author, used by the Spirit of God, is trying to give me a narration or put a logical a flow of events that have happened and try to put the subject before me. Wonderful. Any other answers, please?
The setting in which those words were spoken.
Beautiful. Another word you can say is the setting. Where is it happening? And how are these words placed here? What's the surrounding setting there? Beautiful. Anyone else? Okay, don't break your heads. Let's move on. The English word context is derived from two words. Con, which means together. Texture, which means, or texto, which means to weave. To weave. Look at the beautiful symphony of these words. Thus implying to weave together. You see my shirt? You see the clothes that you wear? It's basically a combination of beautiful threadwork come together to bring a beautiful costume called shirt. Got it? That is the context. You remove any thread out of it, basically you will begin to see the whole thing come apart. Now, if you don't go and find the context of any verse, any passage, any chapter of any book in the Holy Bible, you're basically pulling out one thread after another thread and you will not see the complete garment. God's idea is not for us to learn bits and pieces here. No, you don't just wear a thread, you wear a shirt. And that's exactly what happens when you don't know the context and you go from book to book, reading from verse to verse, doing topical study, character study, you're stuck. And you say, this sucks. I'm not able to go through and get anything. Context is the key, my brothers and sisters. You know the context of the Holy Bible and particular book and all that we will see in a while. Context is what highlights the meaning and enriches the meaning, and you will feel satisfied. Because you are part of a story, I am part of a story, and all the stories are part of God's story. We cannot ever separate these two. And the Holy Bible is God's story told to us, while we are the ones in a way enacting and also benefiting. So it's basically coming together, weaving together. Thus, even the derivation gives us a picture of the value of context in accurate interpretation, right? Context, what does knowing the context do to you? It weaves the text together in an orderly, logical flow, a flow inspired by God, intended to convey his message. Don't get, you know, bogged down by the words that are there. Simply put, when you know the context, you know the flow. Nobody can watch the movie from the second half, middle, or somewhere and know the entire plot. To some extent, you may. But this is more than a movie. This is the most beautiful. You know, sometimes things are complex because they're beautiful. Right? And that is why human body is complex. It is powerfully and wonderfully made. And so also the scripture. The scripture. The word that made us, that's the scripture. It's complex because it is beautiful. What do you need to do? You need to know the flow. That's the meaning of context. We will get to some practical aspects in a while. Knowing the context of the passage is the key to understanding the meaning of the words and the message of the word. Both are important. You need to know the meaning of individual words, righteousness of God, propitiation, grace, all those words you need to know. But also, when you know the meaning of those words, you will know the message of the entire word. But what helps you in knowing both the meaning of the words and the message of the word? Context. Got it? got it? It's the context that will help you know the meaning of any particular word. We will see it in a while now. And also the message of the entire word that is given to you. So what holds the key for us to understanding both the meaning of the words and the message of the word is the context. How do I find the context? Interesting question, right? I understood context is the key. Context is basically the setting, the logical flow of the entire thing. It is basically the shirt that has come together. How do I find it? The context is in the scripture. You don't have to look for another book to help you find context, like, you know, brothers and sisters coming from a Muslim background have to do. You don't have to do that. The context of the Holy Bible is the Holy Bible itself. How do I find you are in John? Let's say I was talking to Ravikant. He said he's doing, he's studying the Gospel of John, John chapter 6. How does he find the context? Let's say my family, we are doing Judges. How do I find the context? Let's see a few things. Number one, first, a few questions have to be asked. Where are we in the book? Am I in Judges chapter 1 or John chapter 6? Where am I? Right? And how is Judges chapter 6 or John chapter 6 related to chapter 5, chapter 4, chapter 3, chapter 2, and the entire book? Where am I in the book? Very, very essential. That is why you can't just sit reading Proverbs and Psalms all through your life. You must move from Genesis to Revelation, and you must basically go to and fro, constantly reading and meditating. So where are we in the book? Whichever book you're reading of the Holy Bible, wherever you are, ask yourself, where am I? What has happened before? Which part of the story am I at? Intervella? Before intervella? After intervella? Climax? Where am I? And how is this related to every other part of the story? Second thing, who is there in the present passage? Judges 1. Who is there? Jesus is certainly not there. Who is there? So you look at all the tribes there. John chapter 6, Jesus is certainly there. Who else is there? They're talking about Moses. Why are they talking about Moses? They're talking about disciples and other people are there. Who is there? Have they always followed? Or is this a new group that has come? Where did they come from? This is what will help. Basically, what you're doing is you're trying to sketch the entire story. You're trying to put the other missing parts of the puzzle to that specific chapter that you're reading or specific passage that you're reading. Third thing, what is happening right here? Of course, how is this related to what has happened before and what will happen later? Nothing in the Holy Bible, as far as my understanding is concerned, nothing in the Holy Bible is out of context or contextless. Everything fits into one context. It may be a smaller context there, but you need to know. Where are we? How is this related to other passages? Who is there right now in this passage? What is happening right here? Who all are involved? What is happening? Next one is, what is basically spoken in this passage and what does it mean? What does Jesus mean when he said, what did the people mean when they said, our fathers ate manna in the desert? What are they thinking? And Jesus immediately in John chapter 6 says, it is not Moses who gave the bread, my father. So what is being spoken of as a subject about bread, about Moses and Jesus? But Moses could not say my father, he could only say your Lord God. But Jesus here is saying father. So what is the meaning? What is being spoken of? Right? You want to basically get a tight grip around the subject there and also the meaning that is concerned to the subject there. And finally, how is this related to everything else that has happened before and has happened later? Got it? How do I find the context? Just the way you find the context if you're watching any movie from the middle. What do? You rewind. You start from the beginning. And thankfully, you can also go forward. And in the Holy Bible, you have the entire Holy Bible placed in your hands. Sit with it and read and study. We break our heads trying to watch web series after web series and play that, go on killing people in PUBG week after week. Please take time. Sit with the Holy Bible. Read. The greatest thing you have in this universe is the voice of God given to you in the Word of God. Don't you want to listen to it? Don't you want to take time? No. I was just telling my wife a few days ago, reading the Holy Bible, not meditating, reading the Holy Bible is a beautiful thing to do. Just read. Just read. Take any book you want. I just read it for fun. I want to read it for fun because this is my story and yet I can read my own story. Right? Find the context. These are the questions. Where are we in the book? How is this related to everything else? Who is there? What is happening? What is the subject that is being discussed? How is this related to everything else? Now, let's do a few exercises after this. No single verse in the Bible, I said this, right, or is out of context. Right? Jesse, can you help me, please? Can you read this, please, for me? What do you see on the screen?
A verse?
Verse. Can anybody give, let's say, Jesse, whatever you're reading, can you give me a verse from your daily portion?
Daily portion.
Doesn't have, it can be a reference also.
One second.
Or anybody who has can do it for me, please.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1:1.
Yeah, John 1:1. That's the verse that he's reading, right? So no, John 1:1 is not an isolated verse. It is basically, Jesse, go ahead and read. The second
thing paragraph.
So the verse is a part of a paragraph. He's not just stopping there. He's basically going to talk more about this word and about why this word existed in the beginning and why it was, the word was with God, and why the word was God, and why the word is not it and he. So it's part of a paragraph. And then the next one.
Surrounding paragraphs.
Suddenly he moves from talking about the word of God and the word of God becoming flesh. So he's moving into another episode there. And then, you know, John comes, and then the people come from Pharisees and they quiz John. So a verse is in a para, but a para is again has another concentric cycle. And that is a circle, that is a surrounding para. And then?
Chapter.
The entire thing is in a chapter. And then?
Surrounding chapters.
And then?
Book.
You see? You take John 3:16. It's in the middle, right? The verse. And my brothers and sisters, if you're only going to read John 3:16 and the rest of the things you are disconnected and disassociated, or even if you read, you act like you have nothing to do with the rest of the Holy Bible because you feel that's important to you, or you read some psalm or something like that and you feel God spoke to you only from that verse, you are going to miss out on a bigger thing. It's part of a big context. And I want to show you at the end that the context of the book will always, in many ways, be the context of any given passage. It may be in the beginning stage, it may be in the interval stage, or it may be at the climactic stage. Whichever stage it is connected. There's one story going through the entire Holy Bible and the entire book. And it doesn't stop there, right? John 1:1 is part of John 21 chapters, which is the entire book. But it's also part of other books. What are the other books that, you know, come before and after John? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and then Acts. It is part of a bigger project. And then, of course, the entire Bible. The entire Bible. What you do is when you're reading, let's say, generally we read a chapter or a verse, right, or a paragraph, right? If you're only reading verses, that means you're just depending on the daily bread or reading those daily biscuits that you see in calendar. You're not going to grow. Move away from that habit, right? What do? You go and you read a chapter, but always know that there are preceding chapters and succeeding. That is why it is important for you to take down notes and summarize the entire chapter into one statement or two statements, which will tell you if you understood anything or not, right? The context is found by taking a verse and saying, what is there in the para and the surrounding chapters and the chapter, the book, and it will always be in sync with the entire Holy Bible. Let's quickly get to doing one exercise, please. Okay? This is the exercise. Matthew 3 verse 11. I'm reading it. You can keep your Bibles open. This is the question. John the Baptist said, I baptize you with water for repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. This is the assignment. What did John the Baptist mean when he said the word fire? Take your time. I'll give you exactly about 2 minutes. 7:23, 7:25. Please come back to me with the answer. If you have the answers, keep them coming, and we will see what the answer is. Use the principle of context. You're free to open your Bibles. Look at, we just saw how to find the context, right? Preceding, succeeding, what is happening there, above verse, below verse. And you please tell me, using all the principles that we used. If you are a group leader, you are welcome to answer. Anybody can answer.
Judgment.
Jesse, is that you?
Yes, sir.
I wanted you not to speak, actually.
Sorry.
Just kidding. Okay, any other answers? Jesse says it's judgment. Before I investigate Jesse's answer, Ronald says here it means judgment. Rohila says zeal towards him. In Book of Revelation, it says to be hot for God. Thank you, Rohila, for mentioning that here. Any other answers? So we've got three answers, Ronald, Jesse, and Rohila. Ronald says it means judgment. Jesse says it means judgment. Rohila says it means having zeal or having a committed, devoted attitude towards God, because in the Book of Revelation, it says to be hot for God or not to be hot. Any other answers, please quickly send them in if you are ready, and then we can discuss. Suyukta says purification. So, Suyukta, you didn't mention anything else, so maybe I want to hear your explanation. Suyukta, can you explain what you mean by purification and why John the Baptist is saying that Jesus will come and will baptize you with the Holy Spirit, and if the Holy Spirit is not sufficient to purify you, again, with fire, he'll baptize you with to purify you. Suyukta, can you answer, please, ma'am?
What I meant is when an iron rod is placed in the fire, it gets melted and we can be molded in which God wants us to be molded. So in that way,
thank you very much for expressing your thought. So Suyukta is saying, just like when iron or some gold or something is placed in fire, what happens is the impurities are removed through the process of purification by the fire, right? And in the Book of Proverbs, there is a verse that says, as silver purifies, as fire purifies silver, context is given there. Thank you, Suyukta. Any other answers, brothers and sisters, before we move on? At least if you take sides here, at least you mention, you can say, I mean judgment or whatever. John the Baptist prepares the way. Rahul is saying that. Rahul said John the Baptist. Rakesh says inner fire, and he put a symbol there. Inner fire. Thank you, Rakesh. So, Rakesh, is it possible for you to talk and explain why you think it is inner fire?
Hi, Na. I was going through this context. So, the Holy Spirit, it talks about the fire. Basically, the Holy Spirit is a fire. Okay, that to purify, to dismantle all our, inner beings, all our sins or something. Kept in our comment, accumulated in our minds. Fire is something that fire, that I can say that I'm jealous for the Lord, something.
Okay, so what Rohila said, having that zeal for the Lord. Okay, thank you. Steve says judgment. Steve says it. Now we have conflicting thoughts, right? It's not like somebody said judgment, somebody else said punishment. No, basically there are three conflicting interpretations. One person said it is judgment, which means it is going to be final, fatal, forever types. Somebody said purification. No, it can't be judgment. A believer is going to become more and more holy and more better. And somebody else, like Rakesh said it is basically zeal for God, and Rohila also said it is zeal for God. And then again, Steve basically took their position. How can there be so many conflicting interpretations? This is what happens when there are conflicting interpretations. We begin to say these words. This is what it means to me. Careful with those words. This is what I think it is. I feel it is. This is what I believe it is. We have to be careful. Because so far, I've been telling you that the principle, the process of interpretation is knowing God's intention. Is there a way to arrive at God's intention by ruling out every other not right interpretation? Yes, The principle is literal. The principle is context. Is the word fire literal? Yes, it is literal. Absolutely. Because fire, in a way itself, is an object that is used to illustrate a particular truth here. So this is literal. But what is the context? How do we know if it is purification, zeal for God, judgment or not? I want to now examine the positions that Ronald took, Steve took, and also, okay, Matthew sent to me saying, as Matthew 3:10 says, thrown into fire or judgment. So Matthew is kind of taking the lead here and trying to answer. But I want to ask Ronald or Steve or Jesse, can you please tell me why you think it is judgment, brothers?
Anna, I think in this verse, it talks about three kinds of baptisms that are involved. Like for the first, it talks about baptism with water. And it says, this is for the repentant. I mean, with water for repentance. And then it is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then coming down, it goes on to talk about that he will baptize you with Holy Spirit and fire for the unrepentant. I mean, so
right.
That's why I took the stand of, I mean, in fact, that is what it interprets, in fact, throughout the chapter.
Right. Thank you. So, Jesse, would you like to give your position, please, and why you arrived at that conclusion?
The word fire is used in the previous verse itself.
Okay.
And it refers to judgment. The axe is ready at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not bear good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire.
Wonderful.
So that is judgment. And after the verse also, it's used in the same way as judgment. His winning fork is in his right hand, and the chaff will be burned up with unquenchable fire. So to change the meaning in between is little awkward.
Steve, do you want to answer? Do you have any thoughts on this? And also, Matthew, you can also answer, brother.
Yes, Anna. And in first epistle of Peter, it says, Anna, for the judgment being with the household of God. So judgment for the believer is like when Jesus says that Father prunes everyone who bears fruit.
Right.
And for the unbelievers, it is eternal fire. So
okay. Right. Thank you. Matthew, do you want to answer? I think Matthew already mentioned. Matthew, if you don't mind, because of lack of time, I'll go ahead. You meant to say what Jesse said, because in Matthew 3:10, which is the preceding verse, there's a reference to fire, which talks about, thrown into the fire. And it's not just talking about God taking us through fiery trials, like it says in 1 Peter or 2 Peter, like Steve was mentioning. But to basically synthesize what three of you said, the answer should only be this. It has to be judgment. Why? Because the meaning is made clear in the context. Now, what did we learn? Jesse, Ronald tried, and also Matthew tried to follow the process of finding the context to find the meaning of the word fire, right? What did the principle that they use? They went through the chapter. If you go through the chapter, if you will carefully realize who all are coming. For example, Matthew chapter 3, please open your Bibles. Look at verse 4. Now, John wore the garments and all of that. Verse 5 says, Jerusalem and Judea and all the people were coming and they were confessing their sins and they were being baptized. Verse 7 says, another group also came. So, you remember how to find the context? Where are we? Matthew chapter 3. Who is there? John is there. Who else is there? People from one region, but also another group called Pharisees. What is happening? Baptism ceremony. How is this related to what is being said here? We will now discover that. See what he says? When Pharisees and Sadducees came, he said, you brood of vipers. He didn't say that to the other people. So basically, he's differentiating between two people. To one people who confess their sins, he baptized them. To other people, forget about baptism. He's almost like passing a judgment of God. And he's saying, you brood of vipers. Who warned you to flee away from the wrath of God? Bear fruit in keeping with repentance, which means they're not bearing fruit in keeping with repentance. They're saying we're repenting, but they have no fruit at all. And don't think for yourselves that Abraham is our father. God can even raise up children from, stones. And then he says the axe is at the root, which is basically you guys. If you don't bear fruit, you will be cut and you will thrown into fire. And then he says, I am baptizing you with water for repentance. But Jesus is coming. He is Jesus, basically, right? Coming after me, mightier than me and all of that. He will baptize you with two things, Holy Spirit. And what is that baptism of the Holy Spirit? The day you're born again. But he doesn't stop there. He says, and fire. Explanation is given there. His winnowing fork is in his hand. And he will clear two things. Threshing floor will be cleared by two things. The wheat and the chaff. Two kinds of people came. Two kinds of expressions were given. One message was given. Holy Spirit baptism, fire baptism. Both are done by him. And then the reason he does both is to separate wheat and chaff. And how does he do it? By the winnowing fork, which is, I believe, is the word of God, or by the process that he does through it. And then he says, it is unquenchable fire. It's not just fire. So why will God take believers through unquenchable fire? So it can't be purification. It can't be inner fire, having zeal and all of that. It cannot be just John preparing the way. While he is preparing the way in a generic sense, there's a specific meaning. Now, brothers and sisters, those of you who did not get it right, please, I encourage you to follow these principles. You don't believe the kind of errors I made as a preacher. Blunders. But thankfully, somebody came along and taught me these simple things. Even as I was preparing, I'm training my mind to think like this. It cannot be enough. Now, there are some, if you're thinking seriously, if you want to counter me, you might want to say, Anna, doesn't it say in Acts chapter 2, when the Spirit of God descended on them, they were tongues of fire? Absolutely no problem or no doubt about the text. You read Acts chapter 1 verse 5. When Jesus said, the Spirit of God will come down upon you, he did not say, you will be baptized with Holy Spirit and fire. He said, you will be baptized from above and you will receive power from above. Somebody sent. True. Next verse, it's, yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Rakesh. Rakesh said, next verse is clearly defined and will be more attentive. Thank you. That's the attitude we need to have. The fire here is hell. It cannot be anything else. It must be care. This is what will happen when you see the context. Who is there? What is happening? What is being said? Who all are involved? What is the thing? Now, let me quickly take you to the important principle here. The meaning of the word fire, it's not in Revelation 3. It's not elsewhere. Here only. Other things may add, but here the meaning of the word is determined by the context. The same word fire is also used elsewhere. But here, context determined the meaning. What an important, that's why you need to know the context. Second thing, the usage of the same word fire is made clear by the context. Got it? Context is the king. They say, theologians say, context is the king. Now look at this picture. I borrowed it from, I just took it from the website that I gave there. The picture there is of a man using a winnowing fork, and he basically tosses it in the air. What happens? When the breeze hits that, all the chaff of the wheat, the skin, which is so flimsy, basically flies away and is thrown aside. And they collect the entire thing of chaff and burn it in fire. A picture of unbelievers ultimately going to be thrown into the lake of fire. But here, the barn, the wheat falls down. Believers, those who are born again. And they will be collected into the barn. A picture of eternal, feast with God, enjoying God forever. The simple principle is this: know the context, you will know the meaning. You don't know the context, you're not going to get at anything at all. Let me take you to the last thing. How many things we get wrong? Let's see this. Think about Philippians 4:13. Okay, this is the test now. Okay, this is not finding the context. Tell me, what can you think of doing while taking this verse? Take a minute and say, this verse says, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Can you think of some things that you can do? And please quickly put it. Because if you're a believer, God strengthens you. What are some of the things that you can do? Because the scripture says, all things I can do because he strengthens me. Quickly, please. You can either speak or chat. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Think of anything that you think you can do because he strengthens you. You can suffer, Prasad says. Matthew says, I can do evangelism and I can be part of fellowship. Wonderful. Emiaka says, live a life of holiness. Praise God. Anyone else? Anything else? Quickly. Rohila, even in times of trouble, he's giving the strength. He is giving the strength to pray. Praise God. Anyone else? Okay, right. Guys, if you are in a position to talk, please talk, because this will save time, right? Now, if you go to Philippians chapter 4 and read the context, it talks about Paul writing to Philippian church, asking them to send him financial help. Now, none of us actually thought about finances, managing your finances. Paul says, I know how to live in abundance and also in abyss. You see, what happens is, yes, we can live a holy life. Yes, we can evangelize. But if we are going to take the original meaning away and place other meanings to it, I think we are basically not finding the intention and the meaning that God wants us to have when we read the particular text. The context there is financial management and learning to live whatever the times are. What are worse for our time, right? A lot of us are losing jobs. A lot of us, money is a, we are at a cash crunch time and all those things. Continue to have faith and submit to God's will. All these things I'm not saying are wrong. Please don't get me wrong. But what I'm saying is, none of us have actually arrived at the right thing, because the thing there is financial management and learning to live the way God wants you to live, because Christ helps you, because you live in Him and He lives in you. Let's take another verse. Revelation 3:21. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him, and he eat with me. This verse is generally used in an evangelistic context, saying, "Believe unbelievers, Jesus is waiting. Come, he's standing at the door and knocking. Open the door. If you come, if you open, he will come, and he will be your savior." But you know the context. He's writing to believers in a church who have become cold, who have basically let Jesus go out of their lives, and they are not allowing him to be the Lord of his lives. And Jesus is saying, "I'm standing and patiently knocking at the door. And you open, and I will come, and we will continue in our fellowship, dining there." But many times it is not used in its right context. Are we doing good by doing that? No. We are basically twisting the scripture, which is what the devil wants us to do. One more favorite of all time, Matthew 18:20. "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them." Many times probably you would have used this in prayer, right? Especially if you are part of a youth fellowship where less people turn up to the youth fellowship. Poor youth fellowship leader is standing there and is praying, "Lord, only two or three people have come together, but you are in our midst." Please go and read the context. We don't have that time. Please read the context. It is about church discipline. When a brother sins in a church, you are supposed to go and confront him and say, "What you're doing is wrong as a believer." If he doesn't listen to you, take one more person as a witness and do that. If he doesn't listen to you, tell the elders of the church. If he still doesn't listen to you, basically remove him out of the church. Church discipline. And Jesus is saying, when you take the decision, when two or three have agreed together, come together in my name to do what I've commanded to do, my presence is with you. Basically, Jesus is saying, when you discipline the church according to the word I'm giving you, it is as good as me displaying, because I am the one and you are obeying my word and doing that. But have we any time used that in that context? I'm not saying when two or three gather, Jesus is not there in our midst. That is there. But this is the original meaning, right? How can we strip it off of its original meaning and add it to everything else that we want? Last one. 1 Corinthians 13. Favorite, right, of all time. We use it for so many things. Love chapter. But what is the context? It is about believers learning to love one another. It has nothing to do with husband and wife. It has nothing to do with, you know, a boyfriend giving, a Christian boy giving a Christian girl some quotations about love. No. It is about how a church that thinks that is gifted in so many things, but if it doesn't have love, what can happen? That's the context. It is even preached at Christian weddings, but the context is different. So my point is this, brothers and sisters. Ronald, can you read this for us, please? You see the statement there, Ronald?
If you don't get the context, you won't get the content.
Got it? If you don't get the context, you won't get the content at all. You may think you have gotten, but you are basically disappointing yourself at the end of your life. Just have one last slide and I'll close. Matthew chapter 16, verse 16 to 18. Look at this and I'll close with this. Peter replied saying, "You are Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered him saying, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." What is the context of this? In this passage, Jesus asked a question to the disciples saying, what does the world think of me, people around? and they give different answers. Jesus says, what do you think? And they say, you are the Messiah, the promised Messiah in the Old Testament. You are that Christ, but you are the Son of the living God. You're not a man, just a man, like David, like Moses. You are God in flesh, but you are our King. You know what? If you go through the entire book of Matthew, the entire book of Matthew is about this. Let me just quickly show you. Matthew chapter 1 and 2 is about the person of the King. That's why Matthew begins with the genealogy of Abraham and David, because Jesus has to come from the King royal line, the person of the King. Matthew 3, 4, preparation of the King. In fact, in Matthew chapter 2, you have the worship of the King when the Magi come from far. And chapter 3, the preparation of the King. Chapter 4, basically the fight of the kings. First fight of Jesus is with the devil, and he wins over all the temptations of the devil. The preparation. Chapter 4, 17 to 9:35 is the law. You remember chapter 4, 17, basically just before chapter 5, Jesus begins to preach from the mount, right? The Sermon on the Mount. This is the law of the King. What he's going to do and how he's going to do is mentioned there. Chapter 9, 16, 36 to this passage, chapter 16, verse 20, the program. What is the program of the King? He came to die, to deliver people. Chapter 7, 16, 21 to chapter 27, verse 66, the passion. Passion doesn't mean a great commitment. Passion means pain. That's why the movie is called The Passion of Christ, The Pain of Christ, right? How people reject him, ultimately unfair trial, and he dies in a vicarious, in our position, a vicarious death, a cruel, brutal death, right? Then chapter 28 is about the power of the King. All these things talk about the same thing, Christ, the Son of the living God, in different aspects. And this is where the entire book has one context. I copied them from one of the, I think, Vernon McGee's outline. Now look at this. Chapter 1, it says, what is Jesus' name? Emmanuel, God with us. Chapter 28, Jesus says, behold, I am with you always till the end of the age. What is chapter 1 to 28? Basically the gospel. God is with his people, and that comes only through salvation. So what is the context of the book of Matthew? Jesus Christ, the King of the Jews, the Savior of the world. Where is it? Everywhere. How do you find it? By carefully going through it. By doing chapter by chapter, passage by passage, verse by verse, and everywhere you will see Jesus the King promised in the Old Testament, the Savior of the world revealed in the New Testament, and everything is about who he is and what he does. Now close here. Taken a lot of time, but I taught you two principles. When you read the scriptures and you have finished asking all the questions, when you want to know the meaning, number one principle, take it literally. Meanings not are always understood. Therefore, you need to dig deep. You need to do a bit of work. You need to do a bit of study. The second thing is, what helps you find the meaning is the context. The context determines the meaning. The context makes the usage of the word very clear to you. I want to stop here. I'm open to taking questions, but depending on how much time you have, you can do it. So we'll just pray, then ask the Lord to help us use these principles, right? Father, we thank you because your word is true. You have given us in your word clear-cut instructions as to how to find the meaning. The meaning is not under our subjection. We don't fix the meaning. You have fixed it. We discover the meaning. Help us to use these principles, Lord, to know the meaning and to live by the meaning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.